Hello out there, you are welcome to DevTut Academy, where we are devoted to building academic excellence in students for the STEM subject. This video is going to be a crash course solution to the chemistry alternative to practical as featured in GCE 2018 exam. And now this is a special request from Victoria. Even though her exam is quite fast approaching, just less than 24 hours, she's saying that she's still needing this. So Victoria, I'm wishing you all the very best. Go ahead and be the best in academy. So if you're out there, you're here to subscribe to the channel and you're watching this, subscribe to the channel so that you can have access to all of our video resources as we upload them. And you, so question number one here is based on volumetric analysis, what is popularly known as titration. We are given two solutions, A and B. A is 0.79 gram of KMnO4 per 250 centimeter cube of solution, and B is of unknown concentration of quite a big solution. And then is that the titration is carried out and the result is being shown on the table below. First, we are to complete the table. And in trying to complete the table, our volume of AUs, because we have initial and final reading, is just for us to subtract. So in the first case, we have 24.80. If we subtract that, in the second case, is as if we are having X and we are saying 34.5 minus X will give us 24. So if you are to mathematically solve this, X moving to the other side and 24 moving to the other side, X will be 34.5 minus 24. So that will give us 10.5. So the initial reading X in this second experiment is 10.5. So we can just put that in that this is 10.5. Okay. And so also in the last case, is as if, let's say we have Y here, and we have 6.55 being subtracted from Y to give us 24.10. Meaning that Y will be 24.10 plus 6.55. So if I have to solve that and put in the value, we also see that our Y will be the addition of 6.55 and 24.10. So if I have to add that, that will be 30.65. So that is the completion of the table as we are requested. So we can move on to our second question. We have to find the average volume of A that is used, and the equation of the reaction is given as this. Now, the first volume of A, we should not use this because it is odd. It's quite large compared to the other two, and it's just like, let's say, a pilot phase is this first sample that we are taking. So the average volume of A solution A that is used will be the sum of the two divided by two, just as if we are finding our average, and that is going to give 24.05 centimeter cube. So question A is dusted. We can now move on to question B. Let me put the value of the values of the volume of A that we have gotten before. So the volume of A was gotten to be 24.05 centimeter cube. Now we have the equation of the reaction, and we have to find the concentration of solution A in mole per decimeter cube. Okay, let's note that per decimeter cube. Now, first and foremost, we need to ask ourselves, how do we go about finding the concentration? In this particular case, we are saying that we can relate true ratio. The question gave us the information that 250 centimeter cube of A contains 0.79 gram of KMnO4. So 1000 centimeter cube, which is relating to decimeter cube, will contain what we can call X grams. Okay, so we just take this as ratio. We can say 250 is equal to 0.79. and 1000 is equal to X. If we cross multiply, the value of X can be gotten to be 1000 times 0.79 divided by 250. So using our calculator, we can easily solve for the value of X by saying, okay, let's move it to the right. X is 1000 times 0.79 divided by 250. So that's 3.16. So that means that 1000 centimeter cube will contain 3.16 gram of KMnO4. Okay. So now that is only the mass of KMnO4. But we can know that our concentration is giving us the mass divided by the molar mass. So the concentration of solution A will be the mass of solution A divided by the molar mass of solution A. And this is done per decimeter cube. Alright, so if we want to put in that, all we need to now do is, we already know our mass, but we can calculate our molar mass. The molar mass for KMnO4 will be that you are taking the molar mass of each of the constant elements, okay? But now we have 4 oxygen and we have 1 potassium and 1 manganese. So we can say molar mass of potassium 39 plus molar mass of manganese 55 plus 4 times molar mass of oxygen 16. And we can use our calculator to add that up so that we have our final answer to be 158. Okay, that's 158 gram per mole. That's the molar mass of KMnO4. So now, since we have the mass and the molar mass, we can now find the concentration of A. I say concentration of A is now mass over molar mass. That will be 3.16 divided by 158. Okay, so that will now, so that's 3.16 divided by 158, and the answer is 0.02 mole per decimal cube. Okay, so the concentration of solution here is 0.02 mole per decimeter cube. So we can also note that is done, and let's just write it out because we are going to be using it to find the concentration of B. So from here we can now see our value of CA is 0.02 mole per decimeter cube. Now, moving on from there, we want to find the concentration of B also in mole per decimeter cube. Okay, now in this particular case, we are going to be making use of the equation of the reaction. The equation of the titration is going to come in handy for us because already we have been able to find the volume of A, we found the concentration of A, we know the volume of B, but we don't know the concentration of B. And in our equation, we know the number of moles of A in relation to B from the balance equation, mind you. So MnO4 is coming from solution A, and the ion is coming from solution B. So looking at the balance equation and the details that we have before, the concentration and the volume, you can say CaV is equal to CbVb, and that is equal to Na over Mb. Okay, so if you want to just cross multiply, you can say CaV multiplied by NB is CbVb multiplied by Na. But we are looking for Cb, the concentration of B. So we divide both sides by VbNa. VbNa. Cb will be remaining alone. That's concentration of B. So that we can have that concentration of B in mole per decimeter cube will be CaVnB over VbNa. Okay, so all the values already, we know them. So we know that concentration of B will now be, concentration of A is 0.02. Volume of A we are given in the equation. We got that in our previous calculation to be 24.25 centimeter cube. The number of moles of B, solution B, is the one from which we are getting the ion, and that is 5. Okay, 5 is the number of moles, so we say times 5 over the volume of B was given in the question to be 25 centimeter cube. Okay, we are given outright in the question, that's 25 centimeter cube, that's VB. Okay, so say over 25 multiplied by number of moles of A is 1 as shown, so you just say multiply by 1. So we can just use our calculator to evaluate this. 0.02 times 24.05 times 5 divided by 25. So this is 0.0962 mole per decimeter cube. So we can also write that out. That we now know CB to be 0.0962 mole per decimeter cube. So we can now move on to the third question. The concentration of SO4 ion in mole per decimeter cube in the solution B. Now this is going to give us quite a run of the money because ordinarily, we already find the concentration of A, we found the concentration of B. But if you recollect, B is a solution of so many things. has indicated in the equation. But now we are now looking for the concentration of the sulfate ion. All right, the sulfate ion that is adjoining to the ammonium ion and the iron ion. So now that means that we need to extract this out of the aqueous solution. So if you are looking at the aqueous solution that we're giving holistically and want to break it down, writing out the aqueous solution, okay, if you want to break it down into the ions that will be making up this solution, we are going to have the ammonium ion, the sulfate ion, and the iron ion. Okay, sulfate is coming in two places, so we have 2SO4 2-, okay, plus. Now iron is only coming up in one place, so we have plus Fe2+, okay. Then the ammonium ion, we have two of them, okay, so we can say plus 2NH4+, okay. So now all these are also in the aqueous solution, you know, they are actually dissolved in water, is dissolved already in water. So now we can now relate the number of moles of the whole solution to the number of moles of the ions that are actually featured. We have 2SO4 2-, 1 Fe2+, and 2 ammonium ion. So already we have gotten the concentration of the solution B in our previous question, but since it is the same volume, you know, actually it's the same solution, so the volume actually going to be cutting out. So if you want to use C1V1 over C2V2 is equal to N1 over N2, that means V1 and V2, they are the same, so they will cover because it's the same solution. Alright, so let me just show that as a means of explaining this. So what we are going to have is, I say C1V1 over C2V2 is equal to N1 over N2. Like I said, V1 and V2 will cut out because actually they are the same. So you can see the concentration of the sulfate ion over the concentration of the whole solution, which we got to be 0.0962, is equal to the number of moles of the sulfate ion, that's 2, and the number of moles of the solution, which is just 1. Okay, yes, that's 1. So that means that the concentration of the sulfate ion, is going to be 2 times 0.0962, and that will give us our answer times 2, 0.1924 mole per decimeter cube. Now, I hope you get to understand this, Victoria. I hope this is clear enough for you to really find a good grasp of it. So, we've gotten the concentration of the sulfates to be 0.1924 mole per decimeter cube. Okay, finally, we are asked to find the mass of the sulfate ions in 250 centimeter cube of B. Now, all our calculations initially will be working in decimeter cube. So we need to note that 250 centimeter cube that we're given. But we'll recall that the number of moles is actually equal to mass over molar mass. That's the formula that will be relevant to us here. And we're talking about the sulfate ion. Now, in the question, we're given some values. But here, if you cross multiply, the mass will be the number of moles multiplied by the molar mass. So what's the molar mass for the sulfate ion? Molar mass of SO4 2-. We just take the value of the molar mass for sulfur, then plus 4 times the molar mass of oxygen, because we have 4 oxygen. Okay, so that's 32 plus 4 times 16. 4 times 16 is, that will be 32 plus 64. Okay, so that will be 96 gram per mole. That's the molar mass for the sulfur ion. Okay. So now you can go ahead to say we want to find that mass, but I was saying that we should note the 250 centimeter cube because the number of moles that we got initially and the molar mass, the unit will help us to clarify. Just watch what I'm going to do, here. So I'm going to say is the number of moles, the mass now is the number of moles 0.1924. that we just got, mole per decimeter cube. See how I'm writing my units, okay? Then times the molar mass. The molar mass is 96 gram per mole. Now, if we are just to divide with this, we are going to find the mass in grams per decimeter cube, but we are told that it is in 250 centimeter cube of solution B. So we need to bring in that also. So we have 250 centimeter cube over 1, but our unit must be the same. So we must convert that centimeter cube to decimeter cube, and that is divided by 1000. So now, with what I've just written now, all the units are going to cut out such that I'll be left with only the grammage. Moles will cancel moles, decimeter will cancel decimeter cube, centimeter cube will cancel centimeter cube, so that finally the answer to get the mass will be 0.1924 times 96. So that will be 0.1924 times 96 times 250 divided by 1000. Okay, that's 4.6176 grams. So the mass of sulfate ions in 250 centimeter cube of solution B is 4.6176 grams, and that is the solution to the question on volumetric analysis on titration. Here we're given the table to be showing the solution obtained by mixing different solutions A, B, C, and D containing zinc sulfate, lead nitrate, sodium hydroxide, and hydrogen chloride. Now, to actually go ahead to solve this, we need to have a good understanding of our qualitative analysis. We need to have such a good understanding, a good grasp of that. And particularly here, because all the tables that we are given is talking about precipitates. So we need to know what reaction will form what precipitate. So we need to know what reaction will form what precipitate. And then after knowing the reaction that forms a particular precipitate, what type of precipitate is, what's the color of the precipitate, what's the nature of it. So that's what is needed here. I don't know if this is just a crash course. You will need to actually gain understanding on that. Now, in the question, we are saying that the solutions are containing these chemical substances, not that they are the chemical substances. So we are only testing for the precipitation that will come. Now, looking at A reacting with D, we are seeing that a white precipitate is formed. If a white precipitate is formed, then we can boil down the solution to that by saying that that means that our A, we need to be hydrogen chloride. Hydrogen chloride is what will react with lead nitrate to give a white precipitate. So, solution A definitely has to be hydrogen chloride. So, A, I can tag to be hydrogen chloride. Okay. So, already I'm suspecting that D will need to be lead nitrate. So, but I can still confirm with some other things. Now, looking at, let me try and see B. B is forming white gelatinous precipitate that is soluble in SS. Okay, it is soluble in the SS of C. So definitely B will need to be zinc sulfate. B I can isolate to be zinc sulfate. I think one of these days I'm going to do maybe a mind map on how to go about identifying cations, anions in salt, soluble salt particularly, or even maybe the test for gases. And once that is done, I think this type of questions will be more easy for us to lay our hands upon and solve. Now, looking at the reaction of C, I'm saying that when C reacts with A, there's no observable reaction, okay? Then that means that our C will most likely be sodium hydroxide. This same C, it forms what gelatinous and precipitate that is soluble in B. B that will go to be zinc sulfate. So only C is sodium hydroxide. Okay? So C is sodium hydroxide. And that is leaving our option D to be lead nitrate. So D is lead nitrate. It's just the good grasp of our qualitative analysis that will allow us to be able to solve this type of question. So, wishing you all the best to go ahead and do this type of question in your exam tomorrow, Victoria. All right. So, in conclusion, hydrogen chloride is the solution here. Okay. Zinc sulfate is solution B. Then sodium hydroxide is solution C. And finally, lead nitrate is solution D. All right. But to give reasons for each of the following observations. One, sodium metal is stored under paraffin oil in the lab. Then the edge of the lid of a desiccator is always greased. Then the standard solution of sodium hydroxide is not prepared by weighing out accurately a given mass of the solid and making it up to the required volume. The reasons are given there. Sodium normally will react with oxygen. It's very volatile. It will quickly react. So you don't want to leave it in interaction with the air. We need to store it under paraffin oil. The edge of the lid of a desiccator is always greased to prevent atmospheric pressure and to make it airtight. And sodium hydroxide absorbs moisture or CO2 from the air, and this will increase the mass during weighing. That is why it's not prepared by weighing out on a mass. All right. Okay, so that's the solution to that. Yeah, we have that sodium chloride is contaminated with methyl orange, and we have to outline a suitable lab procedure to obtain pure crystals of sodium chloride. What we need to do is to just add a treated charcoal that will remove the methyl orange. Then when we heat or boil for some time, we filter, we can evaporate to dryness to extract the sodium chloride. Now, a chemical test to distinguish between HCl and ethanoic acid is to add silver nitrate or lead nitrate to each samples. While precipitate will indicate the presence of HCl and no visible reaction will show that we have ethanoic acid in the solution. Okay. So finally, we are to name three pieces of apparatus that will be required to prepare the standard solution from stock and to state what will be observed in adding dilute HCl to sodium sulfate. Now, it's just the apparatus that we use in the lab. So we have the volumetric flask, the pipette or burette, the funnel, and wash bottle containing distilled water. Now, if we want to observe what we notice in adding dilute HCl to sodium sulfate is that we have a colorless pungent choking gas that will be evolved and the colorless solution will be formed. And that is what we'll notice when we add dilute HCl to sodium sulfate. So that is the end of this crash course based on the request from Victoria from Benin City. We are just wishing everybody out there the very best and academic excellence. Don't forget to subscribe until next time. God bless you.